Good morning. In the name of Jesus, I'd like to welcome you here to Zion Church. I'm glad you all can be here on this spring day. This past week, we had the men's huddle on Thursday night out at the fire pit. That was well attended. Just remember, for you men, every third Wednesday, we're meeting at the fire pit. Every third Thursday of the month, we're meeting at the fire pit. All are welcome. It's a good time of fellowship among men. Also, the women's retreat is this weekend. We had 38 women are at Camp Nawakwa. They've been there some since Thursday, but Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and they come back this morning at some point with the women's retreat. So we pray for them. Margie Mann is still in the hospital. She had 8 inches of her intestine taken out 2 weeks ago. She's recovering, but slowly. So keep her in your prayers. Also on Friday night, Madison Dower says a big thank you. She had a fundraiser for her confirmation project for Panther Pantry, and it was bowling at the Colony Bowling Alley North, and we had a lot. I think we had 7 lanes filled with people. It was a lot of fun bowling with them, and I scored over 100 in both my games, so I was very proud of that, but my shoulder still hurts today. With that, hallelujah, Christ is risen. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Please rise your able and face the baptismal font. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy. Amen. Look, here is the water. Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep, and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In the desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is the water. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Look, here is the water.
Here is
our water. Hallelujah. We'll continue with hymn number 502, found in the Cranberry Hymnal in front of you, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O Lord Christ, good shepherd of the sheep, you seek the lost and guide us into your fold. Feed us and we shall be satisfied. Heal us and we shall be whole. Make us one with you, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Our first reading is from Acts. The next day, the rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were on the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, by what name do you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of good deed done to someone who is sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. May this word of the Lord help you know Jesus and make Jesus known. Our Psalm 23, which will be read responsively. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures, and leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our second reading is from 1 John. We know love by this, that Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help. Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we'll know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever he asks, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey this commandment abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. May this word of the Lord help you know Jesus and make Jesus known.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. May this gospel of the Lord help you know Jesus and make Jesus known.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Amen. You may be seated. Tony Campolo is a famous pastor, theologian, and author, wrote many books. And I had him when I was in college, way back in the early 90s when I did my graduate degree, MBA in economic development. I had Tony for a class. He loved to tell a particular story about a censor taker who went to the home of a rather poor family in rural West Virginia. The censor taker was in rural West Virginia, was on an old country road going down, had to turn down a lane that was about a mile long, went to this pretty log cabin looking house. Out knocked on the door and a mother came out. And he asked the mother, "How many dependents do you have?" And she began, "Well, there's Rosie and Billy and Luann, Susie, Harry, Jeffrey, there's Johnny and Harvey and our dog Willie." But the census taker interrupted her and said, "I only need humans, I don't need the dog. Just tell me how many humans." "Oh," she said, "well, there's Rosie and Billy and Luann, Susie, Harry, Jeffrey, Johnny, Harvey, Ann." But once again, the censor taker interrupted her. Slightly upset, he said he had a lot to do that day. He needed to get on with his work. "No, ma'am, you don't seem to understand. I don't need their names. I just need the number." To which the old woman replied, "But I don't know them by numbers. I only know them by name." In today's gospel, Jesus, the good shepherd, says he knows his sheep by name. I'd like to read you, we read Psalm 23. I'm going to read it again to you, but from the Message Bible. "God, my shepherd, I don't need a thing. You have bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I am not afraid. When you walk at my side, your trusted shepherd crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessings. Your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life. God, my shepherd." Let us start with prayer. May my words and our thoughts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rocking Redeemer. Amen. In today's first reading from Acts, Paul tells us unequivocally what is important. Verse 12, "There is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. Salvation only comes from Jesus Christ." He tells the Jewish leaders so that there's no mistake. He wants them to know. It's the ones that the Jewish leader rejected and crucified that is the cornerstone, that where salvation come from. And any healing, any preaching, all is done through the power of Jesus Christ. Paul wants everybody to know that it's the good shepherd, Jesus Christ, that is our salvation and our healing. And then our second reading from 1 John, I think it's really important, verse 23. It's a creedal summary. A creed, we say the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed, is a concise and carefully constructed sentence that incorporates everything you believe. And so John gives us the creed of the whole Bible in verse 23. He says, "And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us." There it is. That's the whole Bible. Believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. There it is, the whole Bible in one verse, in a creedal statement by John. He also explains what Jesus did for us and what we should do for others. In verse 16, what Jesus did for us. "We know love by this, that Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another." So what did Jesus do for us? He laid down his life on the cross. And then what has he asked us to do? Lay down our lives. But he gives us a thing. He's not talking about getting up on the cross and dying for the sins of the world. Jesus already did that. Jesus did that. He tells us, you want to pick up your cross and follow me daily? What is your cross? Verse 17. How did God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister is in need and yet refuses to help them? If you see a brother and sister in need and you refuse to help them, you don't have Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I died for you, therefore you can die for me by helping those who don't have anything. That's what the Bible says. And then he reminds us that love is not a noun, love is an action. Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. Love is an action. And then in today's gospel, Jesus introduces himself as the Good Shepherd. Of course, the Jews all knew that meant the Messiah, that Jesus was proclaiming that he was the Good Shepherd. He was the Messiah. And that the Good Shepherd knows his sheep, and they know him, and he's willing to sacrifice for them. He loves them enough that he'll sacrifice for them. Have you ever felt like it's not worth following Jesus? Have you ever been discouraged? Perhaps you're going through a severe trial, and you wondered, if Jesus is the Lord and he loves me, why is he allowing me to go through this trial? Where is he? Perhaps you're struggling with disappointment about your Christian experience or what other Christians are experiencing, and you're wondering where your experience is at. So you wonder, why should I follow Jesus? Our gospel answers that question because he is the good shepherd that lays down his life for the sheep. And we're the sheep, and Jesus lays down his life for us so that he can conquer sin, he can conquer the devil in our life, and give us victory over death, eternal life. Jesus' words here in the gospel are aimed at warning, instructing, assuring his followers, assuring each one of us. He warns us about false shepherds. He instructs about himself as the good shepherd and what he provides for the flock. His sacrificial care for us and what he will accomplish. His purpose will be accomplished in us. I want to point out three truths from our readings this morning. If you could take out your sermon notes, 1, 2, and 3 I want to talk about. Number one, the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, but the hired hand has no concern for his sheep. Two, the good shepherd knows his sheep personally and they know him. And three, the good shepherd has other sheep that he must bring into his flock. Number one, the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep, but the hired hand has no concern for his sheep. That's what the gospel starts out with. Jesus contrasts himself to self-righteous, selfish, self-centered leaders, whether it be political leaders, whether it be religious leaders, well, whether it be business leaders. Jesus says he is different. He cares for them, cares enough that he lays down his life for them. He is a servant to them. I give you four ABCD things about Jesus' death. Jesus' death was selfless. Jesus' death was sacrificial. Jesus' death was specific. Jesus' death was successful. I just want to go over them and give you some biblical insight to both to those. The first one, Jesus' death was selfless. Romans 5:8. But God proves his love for us while we were still sinners. Christ died for us. While we were still bad, while we were still sinners, before any of our sins was wiped out, Jesus loved us enough. It's one reason we're to love others unconditionally. Because Jesus loved us first unconditionally, even while we were still sinners. His death was selfless. 2, Jesus' death was sacrificial. Reading from Romans 5:9, much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath of God. We are justified by Jesus' blood. Why can we turn from our selfless ways and turn towards Jesus? Why are we justified? Because of Jesus' blood. We are justified. His death was sacrificial. He died in our place as a lamb died in the Old Testament temple for the sins of Israel. Jesus intervened with his own blood to pay the debt on our behalf. 3, Jesus' death was specific. We read in Ephesians chapter 5, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her in order to make her holy by cleansing her with the washing of water by the word, so as to present the church himself in splendor without a spot or wrinkle or anything of the kind. Yes, so that she may be holy and without blemish. He specifically loved his sheep. The sheep make up the church. That is who he wanted to make clean, so that the church could be raised up in the last days into a new Jerusalem and be wedded with the Lamb, be wedded to the Good Shepherd. His death was selfless, sacrificial, specific, and it was successful. It's one of the reasons we say he is risen. His death was successful. He conquered the devil. He conquered sin, and he conquered death by rising on the third day. His death was successful. If it wasn't, we wouldn't say he is risen. We wouldn't have all those witnesses. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, but the hired hand has no concern for the sheep. The good shepherd, number 2, the good shepherd knows his sheep personally, and they know him. Each night, as the sheep entered the fold, as they came back from grazing in the pasture, the shepherd would examine each one of them to see whether there was injuries or problems and needed his care. The shepherd knew every sheep intimately in a personal way, and the sheep knew the shepherd and trusted the shepherd. That's what Jesus does with us. All our cares, all our burdens, we can take to Jesus daily. Multiple times a day, he cares for each one of you. He loves you. He knows you personally. Knowing God and his son is the essence of eternal life. The crucial matter on judgment day is whether Jesus knows you personally. Yes, Jesus knows everybody in the world. But we're talking about a personal, intimate way. Hosanna, I love this part in Hosanna. Hosanna says, let us press to know the Lord. Hosanna 6, verse 3, let us know, let us press on to know the Lord. His appearing is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. He will come to us. That's gross spirituality, knowing Jesus. That's why I say so much, and why we say at the end of every Bible reading, know Jesus, make Jesus known. Why do we say that? To have a relationship with Jesus. To have a relationship with Jesus, you need to know him, and you need to make him known. Am I seeking to know my good shepherd better each day? Jesus wants that relationship with you. And the third, the good shepherd has other sheep that he must bring into his flock. Jesus' goal is one flock. At that time, the Jews were separated from the Samaritans, who were separated from the Gentiles, and the Gentiles was everybody else. The Jews, Samaritan, and Gentile, Greeks, Gentiles had their own distinct history, had their own distinct culture, had their own languages. They didn't want to be one. They didn't want to sit together and break bread together. But Jesus said, there is one flock. He was willing to lay down his life for everybody. Jesus is a unifier, not a divider. Did you hear what I said? Jesus is a unifier, not a divider. Whenever you see anybody trying to divide people, you know there's a problem there, because Jesus wants to unify us. He wants all believers to be together. I was talking to my son Chad, who's reading a book about nationalism. And nationalism came about, and I can't remember exactly how it came, but it wasn't initially people were just together. And then they started separating, and they separated by having their own history, their own language, their own culture, their own color. And Jesus said, no, that's not how it is. In the kingdom of God, we are all one. We are one flock. So we like to separate ourselves, but that's not how God sees the world. He sees us as one, and we have to remember that. We have to be open to other people that are different than us, that have different histories, that have different cultures, that have different languages, that have different colors. We need to be unifiers, not dividers. The unity of the body of Christ. I mentioned this quote quite often. The Episcopal priest, Barbara Brown Taylor, puts it this way: the only clear line I draw these days is this. When anything tries to come between me and my neighbor, I will choose my neighbor. Jesus never commanded me to love anything else but him and my neighbor. That's all Jesus said plainly. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your might, and love your neighbor as yourself. So if anything's dividing you from your neighbor, you know it's not from God. You need to take a step back. Breathe. What does God want me to do? It starts with your family. I'm not saying this is easy. We have a hard enough time loving family members, let alone church members, let alone neighbors beside us, let alone neighbors around the world. But that is what God calls us to. He calls us to love one another and to love our neighbor. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, but the hired hand has no concern for the sheep. The good shepherd knows his sheep personally, and they know him. The good shepherd has other sheep that he must bring to his flock. The abundant life that Jesus gives consists in having God himself as our portion, both now and forever. That's why you should follow Jesus as your good shepherd. Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you for being the good shepherd and for laying down your life for us. Help us to learn to hear and respond obedient to your voice, trusting that you know better than we do what is best for us. Help us to follow your leading, secure in the knowledge that nothing and no one can ever snatch us out of your loving hands. Shepherd and guardian of our souls, enable us to follow you faithfully every day of our lives, and use us to bring other people into your good flock. In the name of the chief shepherd, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Please rise for the Nicene Creed. With the whole church, let us confess our faith with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and loves has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Shepherding God, gather your church whenever we wander from you and one another. Empower our church and ministries around the world to worship and serve alongside global companies as equal partners and co-workers in the gospel. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Nurturing God, preserve the health of biomes and ecosystems. Inspire scientists, researchers, conservation organizations, and all people entrusted with the task of caring for creation, that we may be better stewards of the world around us. Risen Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, lead nations and communities to share resources, cooperate in solving conflicts, and listen to the wisdom of indigenous people. We pray especially for peace in the Middle East. Help all those with power to share it and to use such power for good. Risen Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, protect the very young and the very old, those living without housing, victims of domestic abuse, and all who live with chronic illness or compromised immune systems. God, guide communities to actively care for people who are vulnerable. Risen Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, help this and all communities of faith to listen to your voice. Call us away from things that distract us from following you. Invite us to more deeply love and serve people who are lonely, isolated, and on the margins. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Healing Father, lay your healing hand on Margie Mann, David Lambert, Brenda Hilty, Sue Belnick, Mary Jane McCuskey, Karen Kaufman, Donald Funt, Dolly Hoover, Don Pickle, Jerry Pickle, Rita Ware. Loving Father, let your presence be felt in Aaron, Carol, Norman, Jen, Greg, Brian, Carol, Willis, Charlie, Mays, Rose, Tilly, Gwen, Debbie, Amy, Marilyn, Ann, Margaret, Doug, Ashley, Kim, Scott, and be with Linda Hubert. Loving Father, be with the grieving family and friends of Joe Hanlon, Herb Snook, Linda Gibson, Bernice Bailey, Nancy Munzel, and Brenda S. Kessler. Heavenly Father, lay your protective hand on Matthew Brandstetler. Loving God, be with our missionaries, Chad Stout and Hannah Cunningham. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Living God, we give thanks for our ancestors in faith. Strengthen us to share the good news in our own day. Risen Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please greet one another. I want to thank you for your generosity through your offerings of time and talents and treasures. Thank you for your gifts. Just want to highlight two. Zion Has Heart is a fund that we raise every February for emergencies for people in the community that come to the church and needs help. You guys have donated over $5,000 to Zion Has Heart. Thank you for that. Also, last month in March, I made a donation of $140 to Panther Pantry, all because you guys bring guests. The more guests you bring, the more money I give to Panther Pantry, so keep bringing your guests. If you're a guest today, I forgot to mention, just fill out the purple card, give it to me at the end of the service, and I'll make a $5 donation to Panther Pantry for you. God bless.
Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witness in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, terrapin and serapin, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise you for your spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he is betrayed by a friend, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant of my blood, shed for you and all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life, and we proclaim the mystery of faith. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us, on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of bread. Rise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Invited to communion this morning. We have an open communion table. That means if you have faith in or of Jesus Christ, you're welcome to commune with us. The ushers will dismiss you down the center aisle. I have the body, the bread in the middle. If you want gluten-free, just ask me. Mike has the blood, the wine, and the grapefruit to my side. Ushers. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen.
Does anybody have a God moment from this week? Any God moments out there? Yes, Kathleen. Praise the Lord. It's a small thing sometimes. Amen. Other God moments this week? Oh no, I think Clint and Lainey with Easter Bunny up there is a good God moment.
Pastor Kevin.
Yes.
It's not a God moment, but we do celebrate birthday today. Marlena Reifert's birthday is today.
Okay. Happy birthday.
Still love me, Marlene.
Our Marlene's birthday today, and our custom, I don't know if it's your, my custom is if your birthday's on this day, on Sunday, we sing happy birthday to you. Lainey, can you get us going? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Amen. Just a few announcements. And if you have somebody you know, a grandchild, a son, daughter, anybody that wants to go, friend, summer camp, we actually have the Jerry and Lee Atkins Camper Fund to help with going to Lutheran camps this summer. So please just see me about that, and we'll make sure that happens. The Mother's Day geranium sale for Spirit Trust Lutheran is available. There's signups on the credenza in the narthex. Stuff the bus this weekend. I noticed people bringing stuff in is for Crystal Palace Northeastern Neighborhood Association. They're getting stuff for kitchen they need. Also, next weekend is Compassion Weekend, April 27th and 28th, and we have a video on that. Love in action and truth, and that's actually from 1 John chapter 3 that we read this morning. Compassion is an organization that works with children. You sponsor a child. Next week we'll have sponsored package here, so pray about it this week. As many of you will know, I worked overseas for many different Christian organizations through 29 years of my life living in Bangladesh. 14 of those years was with Compassion International. What makes Compassion special is what makes this church special. A local church working with children in Jesus' name. Jesus, children, and church. You really can't go wrong with that. That's why I support Compassion, and that's why I support Zion Church also, as we give the word of Jesus to our children is so important. Is there any other announcements at this time? Yes, Will. Thank you. Yep. Next week at 2 o'clock is my installation here at the church. Please rise as we do the blessing. You guys have a part in this. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always.
Thank you. Shaking hands.